And everybody, I can give a big iOSoho hug. Martin Rybak from Yodle.
So tonight we're going to talk about unit testing view controllers, something that should be doing more of, I think. So my name is Martin Rybak. I'm the mobile engineering manager here at Yodle. We're now part of web.com. And what do? We make marketing and operations software for small businesses. And a tool that I work on primarily in my team is called Lighthouse Field Service. And this is an operational tool for mobile businesses like contractors and landscapers. It's operationally embedded, so it's critical the app works as intended all the time because their business depends on this. So when we started about 2 years ago, we came up with a manual test plan that had about a couple hundred test cases, took hours to run. Now, fortunately, we had a QA testing company help us, but we definitely knew this was not sustainable. We wanted to ship faster without fear of breaking things. Does that sound familiar? So quick show of hands, guys. How many of you guys have any kind of automated tests at all in your apps? It's really quick. All right, that's more than half. That's awesome. So like this graph shows, the more automated tests you have, the fewer manual tests you need to have, and you can ship faster. So just a quick overview, different kinds of testing. So we just talked about unit tests. Unit tests is where you test individual components of your app independently. And they're small, they're fast, they're cheap, and they're plentiful. And they're also a great way of documenting your components because they show how the API is supposed to work. There are also integration tests. Integration tests is where you test multiple components together. Those are slower, more complex, and more fragile, but they're more realistic for simulating user workflows. Finally, you can have your good old-fashioned manual tests, where you test your app as a whole, point it to a real backend, but they're the slowest and most expensive, so you want to use them sparingly. So our goal was to replace manual tests as much as possible. So there's a quick little difference between unit tests and integration tests. So what do? Well, we wrote regular old Xcode unit tests for our non-UI classes, and then we used a tool called Appium to write integration tests for our UI. Now, Appium is an open source cross-platform test runner that runs apps in a simulator, and it's a black box test, so there's no access to your app internals. But it's also a black box test with no access to your app internals, and that's a problem because sometimes you want to get to a particular state, and you can't do that without some sort of secret backdoor or pointing your app to some sort of special server. Also, if you have a screen deep inside a workflow, you have to tap through multiple screens to get there. Also, if you have a view controller that's contained in multiple workflows, if you make a breaking change to one of them, it's going to break all of those workflows. Now, as of Xcode 7, there's this new XCUI test framework that behaves very much the same way, but it's also a black box test. You have no access to the app internals, and you have the same problems. So for us, these kinds of tests were just simply too slow and fragile. So what we wanted was a way to test a single view controller one at a time, just like we do with unit tests. We wanted to have a lot of small, specific, isolated tests that could test all the view controller's functionality. And we wanted two kinds of tests. First, we wanted to make sure that given a certain data input, the view controller would show a certain screen output. And then given a certain screen input, that it would show a certain data output. So really simple. Turns out, this was totally doable. Here's why. As of Xcode 5, XC test projects automatically run in the iOS simulator. You may have seen the simulator window pop up even when you don't have UI tests. So inside a unit test, all you have to do to display a view controller is just call step root view controller on a UI application key window. And then you can use a library called KIF to find and interact with views using accessibility labels. Now KIF stands for keep it functional. It's an open source library by our friends over at Square. That's really great. But you have to remember to enable the accessibility inspector in the simulator. All right, so let's see some code. So first I'm going to show you this really simple sample app, right? So here I've got a very simple master detail setup. I've got some items here. I don't know who these names are. Apparently they're like, I don't know who they are, but my team made me put these in here. So shout out to my team. All right, so this is a very, very simple master detail setup. I've got a master view controller, various items. When I tap on an item, it takes into a detail view controller, right? Can't get it simpler than that. But I want to create tests around this, right? So our specs are as follows. I want to make sure that an item name gets displayed on the master view controller. I want to make sure that tapping on an item name invokes an event that opens up a detail view controller. And also, if there happen to be no items in this list, I want it to show an empty label. All right, so let's give it a shot. I've got a standard XC test case, and I've got my unit tests here. I've stubbed them out. You have to prefix with the word test for the Xcode test or define. I'm going to write a test to make sure that the item name is visible, so the first spec that I just mentioned. So first, I'm going to create an item, just a simple model class called ViewItem. Okay. I'm going to instantiate my master view controller. Passing in this init method, an array of items. I'm going to pass in the item I just created. And here's where I'm going to present the view controller in the simulator. So I'm going to call UI application, shared application, key window, set root view controller, master view controller. That's where the magic is, right? So that's going to show on the screen. And then I'm going to use kif. So I'm going to use a command in kif. It's called tester. And this is a C preprocessor macro. I'm going to say wait for view with accessibility label. So I'm going to put test to fail. So what this is going to do, it's going to search the view hierarchy on the screen for a view with an accessibility label of dog. Now UI labels are cool because their accessibility label is actually equal to their text content. Same with buttons and things like that, but if you make a custom UI view, you have to set those yourself. So I run this test right now. It's going to show the view controller on the screen, and it's going to wait, because it can't find that view. After 10 seconds, kif is going to give up and time out and throw an exception. So there it is. So it says fail to find a view with that label. So I'm going to change this to say item.title. Now it's going to look for foo. And once again, it should pass. Ooh, there we go. So now, my next spec, I'm going to make sure that if there are no items passed in, I'm going to show an empty label. So let me take the master view controller. I'm going to initialize it with an empty array. I'm going to throw it on the screen. I'm going to wait for an accessibility label. No items. I'm going to run this test. All right, that passed. And now I'm going to test one more thing. So I want to make sure that, so when I select an item, the API of this view controller is designed to invoke a block property. And this block is like a callback. So it's going to invoke on item selected with the selected item. So I can write a test around that. So I'm going to create item and master view controller on the screen. And I'm going to use a different kif command called tester tap view with accessibility label item.title. So at this point, it's not going to do very much, right? I want to make sure that that block callback is invoked. So I'm going to go ahead and set a handle for that callback. So I'm going to say master view controller dot on item selected equals new item, selected item. Okay, that's my handler. So this is an asynchronous invocation. So to do this, you have to use XC test expectation, which is Xcode's way of handling asynchronous tests. So I'm going to quickly do that. This is just out of the book. So XC test expectation equals self solution description test. Okay. And then inside this callback, I'm going to fulfill that expectation. Fulfill. And at the end here, I'm going to log script to wait for my expectations. So I'm going to no handler. Okay, so I've run this test now. We're going to see a fire up in the simulator. It's going to tap on an item and invoke my callback. There it is, and the test passes. But I got to test one more thing. I got to make sure this item that I got back in the callback is the same as the item that I passed in. So I'm just going to do a simply XCT assert equal. And I'm going to say, I want to make sure that the selected item that I just got is equal to the item that I passed in. So run that now. Should pass as well. All right, awesome. So now I've got a whole bunch of little tests that are really fast and isolated and very independent. I can run them all together now as part of my test suite. We can see the simulator go through and each of them one by one. That's it. That was the easy part. Now, the hard part is actually making your view controllers testable, right? So what makes a view controller testable? And I thought about like one word to sum this up, and I was like, okay, this is the word. Boundaries. Right? You have to separate the view controller from the outside world using clearly defined inputs and outputs. And those can be in the form of properties, methods, or events, and events are in the form of our usual target action, delegation, blocks, and notification center, or KVO. So to make this work, we need, most importantly, testable surface area. So you guys have all seen, maybe written, massive view controllers that do a ton of things, right? So it writes to NSUser defaults, it reads from SQLite or Core data, it makes HTTP calls. And testing is really, really difficult. You're like, where do I even start? And you start importing private headers that expose internals of your view controllers. And the problem is that you don't have enough testable surface area. You can only test at the seams, right, where there's input and output boundaries, where you can set up state and verify its effects. So you can break up this massive view controller into various logical services. Like, say, here are some that we use at Yodle, right? So we have an API service that handles talking to our API and deserializing JSON. The network service wraps reachability. A data service that maintains the core data stack. Preferences service that talks to NSUser defaults, keychain. File service for IO. Theme service for styling, analytics, or stuff like that. So if you do it this way, then there's a huge increase in the amount of testable surface area, and also a huge amount of reusable code you get. So, some tips and tricks. View controllers should not know about other view controllers. I cannot make this clear enough, right? That's why I'm not a fan of storyboards, right? Because they have segues, and you have to know about destination view controllers, you have to cast them and know things. That's bad, because you can't reuse them when they're like that, when you tie them like that. So they should be totally isolated and independent. To do that, move your presentation logic to a separate router object or some sort of other object that instantiates view controllers and presents them. Don't call out to global code like singletons, even innocent looking ones like NSUser defaults, standard user defaults, because it's hard to mock. Actually, with OC mock, you can actually mock class methods, but most other languages that's not possible. So you're better off using dependency injection to inject instances that you can access. So we use a library called Blood Magic. We've actually contributed to it. Highly recommended. Try it out. Also, use a mocking framework. It makes it really easy to set up your inputs and verify outputs in your tests. So we use OCMock. Finally, it's really important, use a build server to enforce your unit tests, ideally before any build goes out the door, so your developers can selectively choose to ignore them. But yeah, that's the idea, right? So gotcha. So what did we learn as we did this, right? So we realized that it's best practice to create a separate testing app delegate, because sometimes your app delegate does crazy things, right? It sets up Crashlytics, it does all these crazy things, and it's just going to mess up your tests. So you can create a testing app delegate by going to your main.m file and doing something funny and just selectively picking which class you want to register as your app delegate. And I have a test project, which you'll be able to access, so you can see how I did that. They're also fast, but they're not that fast, right? So you saw those tests, they took a couple of seconds, but when you have hundreds of them, I mean, you're talking serious time here. You're talking 15, 20 minutes. So we are currently looking into ways we can speed that up by parallelizing them or disabling animations or changing the CA layer animation speed or something like that. So just keep an eye out for that. Retain cycles. You hate them now, you're really going to hate them. Because what's going to happen is a bunch of view controllers are going to be in memory alive, and if they're listening to the same notification, they're going to go crazy. So definitely watch out for those. Also, remember to dismiss any UI windows that you create, right? So if you create a UI alert controller, UI alert view, or action sheet, right, those are new UI windows. Or if you create any custom ones yourself, you have to dismiss those manually. Otherwise, again, they're going to stay in memory and do weird things. Finally, find ways to not repeat yourself by subclassing XCUITest like we did, or adding some methods to KIF to make your lives easier. There's no reason to repeat yourself. So finally, tests are only as good as you make them. They seem time-consuming at first, but they definitely pay off in terms of faster release cycles and just peace of mind. So I highly encourage them. So that's it for my talk. That's the repo with some sample code. And that's my Twitter handle, email. And we are hiring. So we're looking for a mid to senior developer. If you want to join us and do fun things with testing for small businesses, we really count on you. Come see me. Yeah.
Thank you. Questions for Martin? Yes, nice and loud.
So everything was in Objective-C, or using Swift at all? And if so, how we handle, like, OC modules that work in Swift, so how
right.
I guess you have to be more use dependency injection.
Right. So the question is, why do we use Swift, and if we don't, how we handle things like OC modules? Well, we don't use Swift precisely because of that reason. I'm still waiting for a proper set of work for things like that, for mocking and things. I think that's a critical part of our infrastructure. I can't just give that up because of the shiny language. So as much as we like to, I have to wait for that. Yep.
You talked about view controllers didn't know about other view controllers and handle that with a presentation layer.
Yes.
Could you elaborate on the presentation layer?
Yeah, I'll actually show you what it looks like. I've got so we call ours a coordinator class. So this is what it looks like. Well, I should start from the beginning. So an app delegate. All right. So with the app delegate, all it does is fire up an instance of the coordinator, and all those start pointing to it, and then it calls launch on it. And launch is responsible for setting up whatever that coordinator does. So it owns a navigation controller, right? And when it launches, it creates a view controller and sets itself as the root view controller. And then, so here's that master view controller, and it's set up that on item selected, what I do here is I instantiate a new detail view controller, and I push it. I've got a couple of like navigation helper methods down here that find my top navigation controller that's on the screen, because I could have them pushed on top of each other, and I push the view controller on that one. Yeah.
Snapshot testing?
Yeah, that's a great question. So snapshot testing. It's a great observation. So it's another kind of testing that you can do. I find them to be very, very brittle, right? Because they go by pixels, right? So if you make the slightest change or something happens, it'll break your tests. And we're looking for more functionality. We want to make sure that the content that we care about is actually there. The fact that it's a little pixel out here and there, I don't really care. But I want to make sure the content's there. So snapshot testing is an option. We don't currently do it, but I can totally see if it's important for your app to do as well. Yeah.
How much preparation do you find you have to do or set up and tear down for individual view controllers? Because imagine your actual app has something like for data stack or network layer that you have to.
Yeah. That's a good question. So in our setup method, we do create an instance of our data stack, right? So our data service, and we'll create an in-memory presentation only, so there's no database behind it. And it'll kind of always, so most of our tests do have that kind of available always in the background. And we do other things too, like improve the service to make things look good. And we do kind of keep around a couple of core ones every time. Yeah. Yeah.
How stable have you found it to be because XCUITest, for example, and even worse, Appium, like, there's all kinds of extra weights you have to put in because you're waiting for it doesn't find like, a cell collection. Sometimes it finds items that aren't in a collection view that are memory but they're not actually sent on the screen.
Yeah.
What kind of is KIF really good or do you have all kinds of weird things?
Yeah, clearly you have a lot of experience with this because it is maddening. I mean, yes, we have had to make some wait for time interval type commands or wait for animations to finish. It's definitely not perfect. It's a hell of a lot better than we had before, which is nothing. So I have heard about Google's new Earl Grey, library. Yeah, this guy says it's good. Believe him. So we'll look into exploring into that. So it can definitely not without its problems, for sure. So yeah, definitely look into other libraries or other things that could do something similar. But yeah, I mean, we do have flaky tests. I mean, we do have, right now we're struggling with fixing a bunch of tests that are breaking for no reason and we don't know what it is. So, it takes time, but once they do get working, if you're really good at knowing that, okay, the stuff that's important is really under control. Hey, it's Gordon.
Do you have a sense of how many tests you have in your app as well as like how they think?
So we have
1,427.
Nice.
This is Mark. we have a 1,400 test. They're not all UI tests. They're just all tests, all unit tests. We have 1,400 of them. And it takes about 20 minutes to run.
30.
30 minutes, yeah. That's my concern, actually, is that the more tests we have, it gets longer and longer and longer. And it's starting to become kind of like, come on, half an hour is really long. So we are looking into ways to parallelize that or just to shorten that. There are some tricks apparently you can do, like CA layer, speed, and things like that. So we'll check those out.
Do you always wait until all the tests pass before you merge it to master?
Yes. So it's our policy. So generally for a feature, we'll have an integration branch and lots of little branches that go into it. And then that integration branch, our main server, knows to always, because he's the word integration in the branch, and knows to run the tests. And we don't merge it as our policy for PRs, we don't merge it until the test pass.
Questions? No. Well, thank you very much, Mark. Thank you. Let's break for 10, and we'll come back with Jack Flinderman.